Hey everybody, Graham Balachi here from Building Blocks for Modern Humans. Thanks for joining me once again. So lately we've been going through a tour of the different energy sources that humans use to power their modern existence. Last time we went after the electrical powerhouse, coal. This time we're going after coal's fossil fuel, Big Brother, and that represents the largest portion of the human energy mix, and that is petroleum or oil. So in this video, we're going to go through how much oil humans use, where it comes from, what it is, the different types of oil, all the different fuels and products that we can make from oil, and some of the downsides to using oil. So if you want to stick with us and learn all that, that'd be great. If you've made it this far, please like and subscribe, and let's get to it. So a quick intro to oil before we get into this. Oil comes out of the ground, usually almost always as a liquid. Its thickness, how sticky and thick the liquid is, varies from pretty thin to pretty thick and can even be pretty well a solid, which is something known as bitumen. It's a certain type of petroleum or oil. That comes out of the oil sands in Alberta mostly. It's also, just like coal, a fossil fuel, meaning it was some kind of ancient organism. In this case, it's tiny little microbes like algae and zooplankton that get buried with water, mud, silt, and they get compacted down in a situation where there's very little air, and over millions of years, the heat and pressure being packed down turns it into a carbon-rich substance that we can burn for the thermal energy and use that. We can transform that thermal energy into many different things, or it's chemically quite diverse as well, and we can take the chemicals that are present in petroleum and turn it into a bunch of useful chemical products and also materials for humanity. So next up, how much oil does humanity use? Okay, so once again, we see the chart of the world total energy supply. This is the world primary energy supply, meaning the raw form of energy that we use first before we transform it into any other form. So you'll see here that the biggest piece of this pie is oil at 30.9%. So this is a really important energy source for modern humans. Now I looked this up online and the sources below, and this works out to approximately an astonishing 100 million barrels of oil a day. And just for reference, a barrel of oil looks something like this. And here's the thing. A barrel of oil is about 42 US gallons, or about 160 liters per barrel. So we're talking, if you take 100 million barrels of oil a day and use those conversion factors, we're talking about using 4.2 billion gallons of oil per day, or about 15.9 billion liters of oil a day. So that just puts in perspective how much of this stuff we use. And for all the bad things you might have heard about oil or petroleum, this is something we use massive amounts of because it's incredibly important to modern humans at this point in time. So once again here, we have the IEA's World Total Final Energy Consumption from 2019. So just to remind you, this is the form of energy that humans actually use it in. It's been sometimes transformed from its original usage. So unlike coal, and if you remember from the last video, the majority of coal is used for electricity production. Oil is actually, and oil products, petroleum products, which we'll talk about in a moment, are used in their final form as a fuel for almost entirely vehicles. So we're talking cars, trucks, airplanes, boats. These use petroleum and oil products, these fuels, in their final form. So this is the vast majority of what we use oil for. We also use it for materials, but in terms of energy, this is what we use it for, is vehicles. Over 90% of vehicular energy in the United States comes from oil and petroleum products. Very little oil is used to produce electricity. Something like less than 1% of electricity in the United States comes from oil or petroleum products. So that just goes to show you this stuff is used primarily in vehicles at this point in time. Obviously, there could be a transition away from this in the future, electric vehicles being one idea for that. But as of right now, we use oil and petroleum worldwide primarily for vehicular energy. Okay, so now we know a bit about how much oil humanity uses, and that's why it's so important to us. But where does it come from? Well, it turns out there's a conventional way of finding oil and an unconventional way. So the conventional way is there's an underground reservoir, basically a volume of oil that's trapped underground between two types of rock, and we drill down and we pump it up. That is probably what you're thinking, you know, the old West and oil wells gushing out. And that is the conventional way of doing it. And we still do that all sorts of places in the world. There's also unconventional oil, which is a little more complicated. And we'll talk about that in just a second. But here's what conventional oil deposits look like. So here's an image I took off Wikipedia of a typical conventional oil reservoir. The red stuff in the middle represents the organic matter that's been trapped. The yellow strip on the bottom, this represents what's known as the reservoir rock. This is the rock on the bottom that holds the organic matter in place. And then eventually it gets buried by the rock on top, known as the cap rock. This creates a situation where if this is low enough in the ground where the heat from the center of the earth can heat this up in the absence of air over millions of years, that organic matter turns into petroleum. So this is the conventional oil formation mechanism. And then we have to drill in through that cap rock and pump it out, which we'll take a look at in just a second. So in a typical conventional oil extraction scenario, it would look something like this. Up in the top left there, we have our beam pump. We drill down through the different layers of rock. So there's a bit of water on, we have the normal ground, then a bit of water, and then some different types of rock. We get through the cap rock, which is holding all the oil in place, down into the reservoir rock. And it says reservoir rock because there's not actually a big open lake of oil down there. It's a rock that's porous, meaning there's tiny holes within the rock that holds the oil, the petroleum product there. So we drill down into that and we suck it up through the metal casing and we send it on for further processing. As you can see here, this shows quite a few different wellheads in the same oil field. As far as unconventional oil goes, here you see what's known as an oil sands deposit. This is what's featured in Alberta, Canada, which is the country that I'm from. So with oil sands, it's mostly bitumen, which is that solid form of oil we saw at the beginning of the video, and it's mixed up with sand and clay, and it's mined conventionally. So we dig it out of the ground when it's near surface, and we put it in trucks, and we send it on for further processing into eventually the petroleum products that we're all familiar with, which we'll go over later. When the oil sands are too deep to be mined from the surface, there's something known as steam-assisted gravity drainage, or SAGD, that exists where we inject steam down into the oil sand reservoir that's far below the surface, and this melts the bitumen to a point where it can be pumped to the surface. Another source of unconventional oil is oil shale, which has been a huge source of growth in the U.S. oil industry. Essentially, this is a type of rock that contains kerogen, which is what eventually would turn into oil. It's partially decayed organic matter that's, you know, on the way to becoming oil, but is trapped in this rock, sometimes near the surface, sometimes deep below. And what they do is they extract the kerogen and they put it through the heat and pressure that will turn it, they artificially do this to turn it into oil. And this has been a new type of unconventional oil, which has led to vast reserves being found in the United States. What's crazy about the unconventional oil is that there's actually more than double the amount of unconventional oil reserves as there is conventional oil reserves. So these are really important discoveries, and these new methods of producing oil from these unconventional resources will really extend the ability to use oil for humans for a while to come. Okay, let's take a look at where these oil reserves are held. This data is a bit old, from 2013. I'm making this video in 2023, but it's pretty good. This comes from the World Factbook. The darker the color of the country here, the more oil reserves there are, up to a maximum in the scale of 297 billion barrels of proven reserves. So you'll see here places like Saudi Arabia, Venezuela, and Canada have the most proven reserves. There's plenty more oil to go around in other countries like Russia, the United States, etc., parts of Africa as well. But this is where it is concentrated. A lot of this is going to be unconventional, as we discussed before, but there's plenty of oil to go around for now. As far as which countries produce the most oil, here we have information from 1980 to 2022 from the EIA, which is different from the IEA. This is the U.S. Energy Information Administration. So you can see that we're on an overall upward trend from 1980 to 2022, and that the top three producing countries are the United States, Russia, and Saudi Arabia, and the order of which changes a little bit. You can see there's a massive spike in the amount of oil produced from about 2010 onwards in the United States, and that is the shale oil revolution, so an unconventional oil source.
Okay, so what is oil? We know how much humanity uses, and it's a lot, and we also know more or less where it comes from, but what's making it up? Well, what I always like to do is take a look at the elemental breakdown of a substance that I'm learning about to get a good idea of what it is. We did the same for coal, and we found it was mostly carbon, and hydrogen, and trace amounts of other things. Oil is another fossil fuel, so you might see some similarities. Let's take a look now. So here's a pie chart of the different elements making up a typical petroleum. I got these numbers from Wikipedia, where they give a range for each of these elements. And I took a number in the middle of the range and made them all add up to 100 to take a look at what a typical petroleum or oil might look like. So no surprise, just like coal, it is mostly carbon. 84% of the mass of oil is carbon. Just like with coal, when we burn oil and we combine carbon with oxygen in that combustion reaction, it releases a lot of heat and produces CO2. Next up, we have hydrogen at 12% of the mass of a typical petroleum. This hydrogen, just like carbon, when it gets burned and combined with oxygen, turns into H2O and also releases a lot of heat. Otherwise, we have trace amounts of oxygen, nitrogen, and sulfur. So here's the thing about carbon. It doesn't like to be alone. It's kind of like me, an extrovert. What it likes to do is bond with other elements. So remember we talked about the model of the atom. The protons and neutrons were in the middle. And that's what the six protons is what makes it carbon. And then on the outside, you've got these electrons floating around. And these can interact with electrons from other atoms and produce molecules, which are chains of these atoms together. So carbon on its outer shell of electrons has four electrons. And these each want to be paired up with another atom. So this provides a multitude of different combinations of carbon compounds that you can have based on the way it's attached to other atoms. Your basic carbon chain, where you just have a length of carbons all attached together with, you know, hydrogens on the outside is typically what it is. That's why we call them hydrocarbons. These are called alkanes. And that is your basic building block of your petroleum. There's other stuff in petroleum too, known as naphthenes, aromatics, and asphaltics, but we're not going to focus on those for now. Asphaltics, I'll tell you, are what we make asphalt out of, which we can use to build roads. But let's think about these alkanes for now. When alkanes are small, they are kind of thin and much more likely to be a very light liquid that's easy to evaporate at room temperature. When they are long and heavy, they stay in the liquid phase much longer and actually can turn solid at a pretty at a normal room temperature, much more likely than the smaller molecules. So because of these different physical properties, the different lengths of the carbon chains, we can separate them out in what's known as an oil refinery or petroleum refinery. So what comes out of the ground is known as crude oil. It is a soup of all these different types of carbon compounds that just happen to be present in this location. And what humans do is we pull it out of the ground, we figure out the different combinations that are present in a certain type of oil, and we send them off to refineries to be turned into a bunch of different products. Let's take a look at how these refineries work.
Here's a graphic representing what happens in a typical oil refinery. So in the top left, we start with an oil tanker bringing in crude oil from wherever. That gets put into onshore tanks, which then gets piped down into a furnace in the bottom left there that's heating up the crude oil. That then gets piped into a fractionating column in a process known as fractional distillation. That's what's going on here. So the idea is at a certain temperature, in this example, 350 degrees Celsius, so pretty hot, the lightest fuels that are present and the shortest carbon chain molecules, these alkanes present in the crude oil, they turn into gases at lower temperatures. So at the bottom, it's hot, it's 350 degrees Celsius, so all the lightest stuff turns into a gas and rises to the top, and we get different fractions along this fractionating column of different sizes of carbon molecules, these alkanes. So the heaviest ones are at the bottom. In this example here, it even actually mentions bitumen, which is a solid. And then the heaviest one is fuel oil. As we go up, we get into the lubricants and wax, which we don't always use as fuels, but they are present in crude oil. Then we go up to the familiar diesel oil, which is for buses and trains and heavy trucks. Then we move into kerosene, which is jet fuel. Then eventually gasoline for your typical cars and trucks. And then eventually the fuels that are almost always gases at room temperature, like we call them petroleum gases, that might be your propanes and even natural gas, which is methane, the lightest one of all, which we'll talk about in a future video. That's what you use in your barbecue there, which is why it looks so familiar at the top.
So as far as different types of oil that humans find out in these deposits worldwide, there's a few different words to describe them. Now, no, they're never the same. They're always a bit unique, but they can have a lot in common for each other. So there is a system that humans use to describe these types of oil. So when it shows up a refinery, you know more or less what you have to do to it to turn it into the different types of fuels and products that we want. If there's a lot of the long chains of carbon, this would be known as a heavy oil. If there's a lot of the shorter chains of carbon, this would be known as a light oil. Remember, we saw that one of the other elemental constituents of petroleum is sulfur. Well, this amount can vary. If there's a lot of sulfur, we call it sour. If there's very little sulfur, we call it sweet. So put these together and you can have a heavy, sweet or sour oil, or you can have a light, sweet or sour oil. There's also a number we can use to describe the different types of petroleums out there. And this comes from the American Petroleum Institute. And it's known as the API number, the American Petroleum Institute API number. Basically, the higher this number is, the lighter the oil is. The lower the number is, the heavier the oil is. So let's take a look at a few examples now.
So here in this graphic I took off Wikipedia, on the vertical axis you'll see the API gravity, which means the API number. The lighter fuels are on the top end of this range. The heavier fuels are at the bottom end. On the horizontal axis, you'll see the sulfur content. So as we go right, we have more and more sulfur. It becomes more sour. You'll also see there's a bunch of different names of these different types of fuels. And these are typically named after the region of which they come from. Not always, but usually that's the way the industry does it. So we'll see things like the WTI blend, which is the West Texas Intermediate blend, is a pretty light, sweet oil. And then we have something like Maya, which is on the other end, is a much heavier, more sour Arab light, somewhere in between. This is just an example of the different way we classify the different types of oils that are out there.
Okay, so now we know that petroleum is a soup of different carbon compounds that can be refined into different types of fuels. So what are these different types of fuels? Here are the most obvious examples. We have
gasoline, fuel oil, diesel, kerosene.
We can also turn petroleum into a bunch of valuable products that we don't use for energy. We're not going to burn them, essentially, but we can use them as different types of materials or for different chemical purposes. Here's a bunch of examples of those.
Asphalt, which we talked about before, we use it to make roads. Lubricants for engines and motors. Plastics, a very important, strong yet lightweight material that we use for pretty much everything now. Solvents to dissolve various other chemicals. Refrigerants for air conditioners and refrigerators. And countless more, which shows how important oil or petroleum is for purposes beyond that of just fuel or energy.
So what about some of the downsides of using oil? Obviously, this is a very energy-dense substance that can be turned into a variety of different useful fuels, as well as materials and different chemicals that we use all the time. So it's very valuable stuff, but there are downsides to using it. When we burn a petroleum product, all that carbon gets combined with oxygen, releases heat, which we like, but produces CO2. Now, this CO2, as we talked about in the coal video, its concentration in the atmosphere has been increasing. And a lot of scientists today think that this is leading to a change in our climate. So that's something we have to be aware of, that we maybe shouldn't burn all the petroleum that we possibly can, even though it is valuable stuff. Additionally, in the extraction and the transportation of oil, occasionally huge amounts of it get spilled. This has happened a number of different times to humanity, and it's a really hard thing to clean up, and it can be kind of toxic, and it affects wildlife and human life negatively. If we're as responsible as possible, this happens very rarely, but it is one of the major downsides, is that it can be polluting when it gets spilled. Kind of obvious. All right, so that's all for this time. We can go into more detail of petroleum in the future, but that's a great introduction for now. If you've made it this far, please remember to like this video. It really helps with the YouTube algorithm. And if you want to see more of this content, please subscribe. So next time, we're going to be talking about natural gas, the last of the fossil fuels that I'm going to talk about in this series. And I'm really looking forward to making that video, and I hope you'll join me for that one too. So thank you so much, and we'll see you next time.